Hey, Zombro fans, Rousel Toysman back here for another wonderful week of Zombro's action, and I'm joined by my co-host, as always. Say hello, Matt.
Oh, hey, what's up, guys? Haven't seen you in a while. How you doing?
Far too long. We're also here joined by Johnny J25. Say hello, John.
How's it going, everybody? Matt, glad to have you back on.
Glad to be here.
And we finally, the much-requested glitching queen, we finally have her on. Say hello, yes. Queen.
Hey, guys. Hello. So, I'm glad to be here. That's awesome.
We are so excited to have you on, and it's just so exciting that we actually have so much to talk about, too. It's not one of the dead periods. Yeah. Oh, my God. We have Gorod Krovi, crazy stuff coming out with the Wisp and all that information. But before we even get into that, dive deep into this, let's talk about the tease we got from Comic-Con today of Infinite Warfare Zombies. Do you have any like initial reactions or thoughts about Infinite Warfare Zombies and going forward after Treyarch Zombies?
Well, doesn't this image feel very Dead Ops Arcade to you guys? Is that just me?
I heard a couple comments about that. Yeah.
I don't know about this. I don't know about zombies in space.
Mm-hmm. I don't know about that either. It really concerns me that Infinite Warfare, where it's going and where the teasers are as of yet. But I'm not like the hate train is what blows me away is how much hate Infinite Warfare has got. There's not even like little out about it for the zombies mode. And it's an instant dislike. Don't want to talk about it. Don't even want to think about it. It's like you don't have to buy the game. Let's see with the gameplay first before we start absolutely destroying what it is. And I was shocked, even on Milo's video today, just the amount of just straight-up hate for this. It's a Call of Duty game. Like, I don't understand the difference this time around.
I didn't realize that I didn't realize Infinite Warfare Zombies was getting as much hate as it was. Like, of course, Infinite Warfare is the bandwagon that everybody loves to just burn into the ground, but is this getting as much hate, too?
You're talking about the zombies thing?
Yeah, Infinite Warfare Zombies. Zombies.
I mean, just looking at how it looks a little cheesy. I feel like it looks like a mobile game more than a console game teaser, but you can't judge a book by its cover, so we don't really know what we're getting yet.
Are you guys keeping an open mind?
Yeah.
Is that the idea here?
Yeah.
How do you feel about the Queens?
You know, they were talking really big about the Easter egg side of things, that they're going to have the best Easter eggs. It's going to be better than Treyarch's Easter eggs. I think they are kind of like alluding to that. So I'm excited to see that. And I know there's going to be a lot of comparisons, but I guess you really can't compare. But no, I'm excited. I'm going to be open-minded to it and just, you know, understand that, yeah, Treyarch is pretty, number one on that. So it's going to be hard to compete with them, but yeah, I'm open-minded. You know, I was open-minded to Extinction and Exo-Zombies, and so, yeah, I'm excited, I guess.
That's a great point you bring up there, because in that little interview we had, I'm not sure if that head actually got let go or left the studio in between the time he took that interview. Someone left big for Infinity Ward in between that interview, but that's awesome to hear about the idea of Easter eggs being even better, even deeper than what Treyarch has to offer. Does that mean we're going to get, you know, the Exo Zombie, like, let's real efficient and then walk around a deck drunk? Or are we actually going to get these Easter eggs where, you know, we're riding dragons and defending ourselves against Manglers? I keep calling them Wranglers. I have no idea why that keeps happening. But it is so exciting about the potential. I don't see right there for Infinite Warfare Zombies for me is like the potential to succeed is so much higher if you keep an open mind, where the initial hate, there's no way this game could be any good. This needs to be like Half-Life 3 to be any good compared to the hate it's gotten so far. And there's no way they're going to deliver on this.
Well, the one thing I want with the Infinite Warfare Zombies is for it to have its own identity. I think if they went out there and they started to put ciphers into their own maps, just in a very similar style to Jason Blundell, then the community would instantly hate it, instantly say they're copying Blundell. But I look at this new art style. It is very cartoony, and that could end up being a hindrance. But I look at it and I say, at least they're trying to do something new. At least they're trying to be different. And I appreciate them going for their own identity. Was Extinction really that bad, though? It didn't have replayability, but it wasn't awful, I don't think.
It was okay, but I didn't like the way that the aliens jumped at you. It was just really frustrating. I didn't like that style. I was like, but
what'd you think about the leveling systems? Like, and all the perks you could bring into the map and the equipment. What'd you think about that?
That was cool. That was kind of like a first in seeing like that for us on like a co-op mode. So
the class system?
Like,
oh, yeah. I had to think. It's been a while since I've played. I had to rethink about it. I'm like, wait, the perks? And then I remembered how the classes work.
Yeah, because I think that was a really cool and different idea. You know, Traeger Zombies, you don't have created class systems. But the one thing I did like about Extinction is you could level up, and then you could get, you know, your turrets and stuff like that. It was frustrating, though, from, like, you get a level 35 versus a level 1. The 35 is going to be just have such an advantage over the guy first starting out. But if it's a different brand, that's not necessarily a bad thing that we have someone that's further ahead, further along, and able to really do a lot more with the game because he's invested more time with it. You know, you get to reward yourself. I think it took a little too long to level up, and they started doing teeth and or tooth.
Oh God,
I forgot what it was.
Yeah, the teeth.
If they implement another teeth system, I'm going to be upset because, oh my God, that just took too. You needed 1,000 teeth for their greatest upgrade. Nobody earned that legitimately.
Oh, my ridiculous. God, 1,000? Oh, I did not know about that. I just
watched
the
Relaxing
Ends. Didn't
you get like
one
per game too? It was absurd.
I don't know. I didn't play it enough to know, to be honest with you. I just watched Relaxing End, and that was the best Extinction I could do there because he just makes it look so much fun. And then you get in there and you're like, what? What happened?
What is this game?
All right, let's get on to the next question here. This was something that fans submitted to us, and we just had the wonderful PPSH return in Gorod Krovi. We have the next Revelations coming out. Who knows what this could be? We're talking about this house. This could take place just about anywhere, this new map. Do you have a specific gun you would love to see come back? Some kind of callback that'll make you so excited like so many were for the PPSH.
I really like the AUG from Black Ops 1.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
that might be
awesome.
My favorite gun in that game. And then when you pack a punch it and you get the underbarrel shotgun, much fun. That would be great to see come back. Or the dual-wield shotguns, the HS-10.
Yes, they need more ammo.
That'd be great as well.
Yeah, they used to be HS-10.
I really was disappointed to see the MG42 as a mounted weapon in Gorod Krovi. I wanted I hated it, dude. You can't get off of it. And it's
I haven't even touched it.
Yep, you just hit circle.
I've done that. It never works.
Maybe hold. It might be hold circle, but yes, you can get off it.
Well, that's good news that I didn't know because I was like, what the hell? How am I supposed to stay alive in solo with this thing? Anyway,
exactly.
I found no reason to use it.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, there's no reason to use it. It's
1,000
points. It's not even that much better than a regular weapon. If it was a gun you can get out of the box, that would make me genuinely happy. I'd be super stoked to see the MG42 or the Browning come back in DLC 4.
There's too many LMGs in the game already. We have
true.
Three
it's
LMGs.
It's not
going
to happen. Neither of those are going to happen.
Like they're the only weapons I get sometimes. And they're useful, but I seem to get them a lot.
Interesting.
Yeah. I don't think either of those are going to come back. I would love to see them, though.
Interesting. How about you, Queen?
Galil or Commando?
Or just, no.
The Galil
I want a Commando-Galil mixture gun. Like,
yes.
I think that would be awesome. I love the sights on the Commando and the way it looks, but there's not enough ammo. And then the Galil is just like, yeah.
Glow's a beast.
After getting the Galil in Black Ops 2, I've decided I never want to use that weapon again. I feel like I've overdone it. It was my favorite gun in Black Ops 1. I was so excited to have it back in Black Ops 2, but I just got burnt out on it.
Interesting. Now, that combination, you got me thinking, because my favorite weapon ever in zombies, but we're going to talk custom zombies here. This hasn't happened yet, is the ACR from Modern Warfare 2's ACR. That gun has ammo. It shoots like a laser, and the sights are just, right on. That's why the Commando was like my substitute for it. I would love to see that come back in some shape, way, or form, but the MG42 was just absolute favorite weapon from all of zombies besides the PPSH and MG42. They go hand in hand. I did like the mounted version of it, but you're right. It'd be cool to get it out of the box. Shotguns are such a really, really good addition as well. Those are great ideas. God.
Wait, Reed, if we're pulling from other games, can I pull the laser wonder weapon from Exo Zombies?
That the limbo gun was not too bad, to be honest.
I love the limbo gun. That was so much fun.
Yeah, it was an interesting idea just to have this beam of energy shoot at certain levels and go straight. Yeah, why not pull from it? Pull from the zombie universes right now, because this is a really fun idea to see what we could have in a DLC 4, because Treyarch has shown us that, we'll take little bits and pieces from everything we see.
Well, they did a nice thing in Origins when they included so many different weapons from Black Ops 2. I think that map has 4 or 5 new weapons. Mm-hmm. And if we're supposedly going to the infinite or the infinity or the house, whatever we want to describe it or call it, then there is potential to put a bunch of throwback weapons in. The Origins house has items from almost every single map. Why can't a map set around the house also have weapons from almost every single map?
That's what I was thinking.
That's an excellent point. Yeah, that's a great point.
You nailed it.
It'd be like the clip show of zombies.
You get every single, the best of every single thing we've already seen. That'd be crazy.
More than anything, I want every perk to show up on the next map as a machine. More than anything, I want that so
bad. That'd be so crazy, dude. Imagine how many, what is it, like, it's 14 perks? How many perks are there? God. There's so many.
13 right now.
13?
I want every perk, but I thought the Wonder Fizz machine was an excellent solution to the problem of a map getting cluttered with perk machines.
That's a good point. I do have loading errors as it is.
But every perk should be equally as common. It shouldn't be this bullshit with Widow's Wine where I have to spend $100,000 to get it.
They did patch that.
Are you sure? Because I've yet to see Widow's Wine in Garrod Krovi.
Yep, I've gotten it.
Doesn't like two or three games now. Just doesn't like
I mean, I've gotten it just for Alcoholic, like just not the Wonder Fizz.
No, that's what I'm saying, Wonder Fizz. Getting it out of Wonder Fizz. So, I've gotten it two or three times.
You guys
is it better or is it equal, though?
I want it's about the same, dude. I don't think I've gotten anything more. Maybe Deadshot might be the only one I'm likely to get more than anything else.
Absolutely. I get that shit all the time. I hate it. Do you guys think PhD Flopper's going to come back?
Oh,
that's been a much. Hot topic here.
I don't know if we have a use for it anymore.
Well, they would have to take away the slide.
Yeah. You know?
So it'd be like, well, we'll disable your slide, but you could flop instead.
When you slide, it explodes. Banana colada gone.
Maybe they call it the slider.
If they just took out the flop. If they take out the flop itself and they give you all the bonuses of PhD Flopper and they just said, we don't have a dolphin dive, would you still be okay with that?
I don't know if they're going to do that now, though, because they have the gum.
Right.
Which is basically the biggest thing.
We have Danger Closest and the Banana Culotta Gobble Gum. I don't know the name of it. That's
hilarious. Danger Closest protect you from the ray gun?
Yes, it does.
Okay. Yeah. So then.
What was it, Matt?
I don't know what it is. It's,
Slider?
I don't remember
Slider
what it's
Collider, something like that?
No. Not a bad name, though. Not a bad name.
Yes, I don't know where that came from. That seems like the answer. Like, we don't need PhD. You literally have all the gobble gums that make PhD what it is. And
so
it was a
every single
very
perk
overpowered.
You want except for PhD.
Pretty much, it seems like it would shape up to be for the final map. It's exciting to see where we can go for
right back. That'd be great.
Yeah, it was perfect for this map, too.
That was also overpowered.
Vulturade?
Yeah.
Nah.
Oh,
it was
dude,
a camper's
Vulturade
best
was...
friend.
Oh, that's the best
one
perk,
zombie,
dude.
And you have a puff of smoke that you can hide in.
That
wasn't
perk
every
was
zombie,
so
though. It had
great.
To be the specific zombie.
Yeah, but there were a decent number of them. There were plenty.
True, but you could rebalance that in a new way to bring it back.
Yeah, you could lower the number of gas spawns.
All right. Well, now that we've been digging into all this, have you ever had this instance of viewers really wanted to know from you guys, is there ever, on your palette of zombies, a map that truly got you excited more than ever before? A map that really you'd like go to bed thinking about it and wake up in the morning like, ugh, how many weeks until the map comes out? What map got you that hype, if any, ever?
Horizon for me.
Oh, yeah?
I guess it was just the idea of this castle and just being able to like play in a castle was just so different.
Do
you, know?
You love medieval castles?
I kind of do now. Yeah, I do.
That's awesome.
A sucker for medieval castles.
I do. I love it. It just feels awesome. I love the Wrath of the Ancients bow, and just like that, just that bow and just running around the castle just feels like you're really there. It's like, oh, it's awesome.
I mean, it is considered one of the greatest maps of all time. It delivered in a big fashion. So that's an awesome map to get hyped about and then have it deliver for you.
Yeah.
What about you guys?
I don't know if there's ever been a map leading up to it that I've been super hyped about.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe Shadows of Evil. Maybe the release of Black Ops 3 is what got me super hyped. But I remember when Call of the Dead was released, I was so excited to play that map, even after the release of it. I have this memory of me coming home from school, and my dad tells me that I have to go mow the lawn. And as I'm mowing the lawn, the entire time, I'm just planning out the game. I'm like, all right, first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to make this route. I'm going to grab these perks. I was planning it out. I'm like, all right, what's the most optimal perk setup? And how do I want to go about reaching the high rounds in Call of the Dead? I wanted to play that map so much. It was the first map, I think, that I got right as it released. Because I didn't really get into zombies until Black Ops 1.
Right.
And then I picked up Ascension probably a couple weeks after it came out. But then I got Call of the Dead as soon as it released, and I just played that map to death. And I just have this very distinct memory of me trying to mow the lawn, pushing the lawnmower as fast as possible just so I can get back and play it.
I love it.
Oh, my God. That's great. What about you, Matt?
I got to say Moon for sure. I'm pretty sure August 14th was the release date, because that date just sticks out in my head so much. I remember waiting up for it all night, played it for 14 hours straight with the squad, Javino, Starburst, and Champ, who are still the squad today, which is so crazy. that map was insane, and then Nick found the Easter egg for it, and it was just, that day was absolutely amazing. The one thing I will say, though, is since then, I've never had a map come anywhere close to as hype during playing it for the very beginning as their Eisendrock. Because I mean, I told you guys, know I stayed up for 3 days straight, pretty much streamed 30 hours straight, had to go to the hospital. That's how dedicated I was. Wait,
what did
to
you
that
have to
shit.
Go to the hospital for? Did I miss this story?
I don't, he told it to us before. Were you dehydrated or something?
Yeah, so oh, I basically right, streamed so long I didn't eat or drink or sleep for anything. Fault, yeah, I just totally lost track of time. And my stomach started to eat itself.
Lost track of time.
So I had to go to the hospital.
Matt walks outside and
he
hasn't seen the sunlight in that long.
Dude, it's exactly. I walk outside and it's sunlight. I'm like, wait a minute. Is it the morning? I don't know what day it is. It was that
bad. That's so bad.
Yeah.
Wow. Was really bad. I'll tell you, Matt, I had bad luck when Moon came out. You just reminded me of this. For some reason, my internet went out the day Moon went out. Moon came out, so what I did was I took my Xbox. It was originally in my basement. I carried it up to my room, where I was just barely able to connect to my neighbor's Wi-Fi. And then what I did was I went to move my Xbox, and I didn't know this, but apparently if you move the Xbox while it's running, you will burn the disc.
Yep,
burnt my Black Ops disc. And then I had to run to Walmart to buy a new copy of Black Ops just so I could play Moon.
Oh, man.
That's brutal.
Wow. That puts a bad taste in your mouth before the map comes out. Oh, man.
So I woke up at 5 a.m. to download it and everything. I was so salty.
Yeah, I don't blame you. That was a pretty exciting release. I know some of the most excited I've ever been. Ascension was like the first deal. Like everyone, it was an exciting map. But then, you know, throughout, like Shangri-La was a good one because everyone was so excited about the stuff we saw. I remember the community was really big about the Easter eggs at that point, more than like they had been in year or like the previous ones. Like Call of the Dead was cool. They finally had that build because Ascension, we didn't know we were getting a quest Easter egg. Then all of a sudden it's like, oh my God, this is a pattern, Call of the Dead. And then finally we get Shangri-La. Everyone was really hyped for that. But I remember the most hype I probably was ever. I was at school. It was my senior year. I'm so excited. I'm going to workouts after school for baseball and all this stuff. And we have conditioning. We're off season right now, so it's okay. And all of a sudden, I get the word. I get the email. New trailer dropped. Black Ops 2 Zombies. I'm excited. My buddy's like, you going to workouts? I go, no. I get my car. I drive home as fast as possible. Sprint in the house. Watch the trailer. And then I see Transit. And my hype was so excited to the, oh, what? Because I just got the email. I'm like, oh my God, the characters are back. Maybe it's after Moon. So much could be happening. And then I got Transit. And so I remember it was very, very disappointing for a long time until we got the Origins intro. And that got me so crazy. Like that one was super, super excited. I'm moving into college. I'm so, so pumped. And then as soon as the map releases, you know who leaks the ending cutscene. I'm just like, oh, and everything's a game. There goes all the hype. He just broke my heart again.
Reed, you just reminded me. I first saw the trailer Transit while I was sitting on the toilet, which I feel is very indicative of the map.
Oh, my God.
That's funny. You're a funny guy, John. You're a funny guy.
But I don't think it's any true, map it has was, delivered.
It's like it was psychic.
Transit. Oh, God.
But, like, I still agree with both Matt and Glitching Queen here, is that I've never been hyped. I've been excited for maps. Like, those are the reasons why I don't get as excited as I do. But the Eisendrock stuff really got me excited with Dempsey and everything going on. And then it delivered. And that just
brought me. Are you sure you guys just weren't hyped that you were at Treyarch Studios?
Well, that's a different story.
Nah, I think the trailer for me was what hyped me so much. That trailer was just like, holy shit, this is going to be crazy. I don't know why.
It's just the way Dempsey narrated it and the whole thing that presented it. It was a great presentation. And then actually playing it, it was like they didn't get it wrong. Like so many times where you load the map and you're like, fingers crossed. Well, that's awesome. That was a great question. And Next comes from, again, the viewers. They are curious, where do you think Zombies would have gone if Jimmy Zielinski was still in control here? If he was still the head of Zombies, would we have gone the direction we had now, or do you think we'd be somewhere else? Do you think we would have gone down different rabbit holes?
Oh, I think we would definitely be more classic Zombies, like Black Ops still. We wouldn't be doing Cthulhu and all this other crazy stuff. It'd probably be way more classic, I think.
Where do you think that would have taken form, particularly? Do you have any ideas where he might have pushed to after Moon? Or Transit, actually.
I don't know. Yeah,
it's a tough question, for sure.
Yeah,
I'm just curious about it because it is like one of those things that shoulda, coulda, woulda. Jason Blundell has dramatically changed the storyline with the reveal of the Monty Wisps and the quotes there. Monty has told us that World at War is just a different dimension, a different offshoot of the main universe that got shattered during one of these events, whether it was the Origins ending or some other event that hasn't been
brought to our attention. I think you're misinterpreting it. I think he says that World at War is the main line, the main line of time.
I don't know about that. From what I heard,
he says that they fought in World War One, and then they got captured and became German lab rats.
He says, and I
feel like that describes what originally happened in World at War. We just didn't know that they were World War One soldiers until Origins.
I think the connection, though, is off, because I'm pretty sure he says you did fight in World War One, and then there's a stop. It's not then World War Two. He stops his train of thought, because in that sentence, you're telling me that they're going to look exactly the same for 30 or 40 years, or what is it, 30 years, a 30-year change there before the experiments start happening and they lose their minds and change their complete, I guess they do change their look completely from Origins to what would be.
Well, no, they age.
Yeah, okay.
They grow. All right.
You might be selling it here.
You can interpret it in many different ways. It really doesn't matter what the original timeline is, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Because they can rewrite
the universe has been shattered.
Okay. What about you, Matt? How do you feel about this? While I'm looking up the Wisp quotes.
God, I don't know. This is like a really, really difficult question to answer, because you could say whatever you want. You know, you could be like, oh well, it's gonna happen this way. I have no clue what would have happened if Jimmy Z was still the guy. You know, how much more of the same thing can you do? Can you make World at War different slightly and do it for three games after that? I don't know if it would work. I also think, though, that Jason Blundell's path with Zombies has gone to a less zombie-focused world. Like, a lot of the stuff now, the fact that there were dragons in this map and all that jazz is just like, eh. It's not really the Zombies we once used to know. So
right.
I think Zielinski would have kept it more close to what we played originally. But maybe it would have died a little bit, you know? Like, how much of the same game can you play? I think that's why everyone hates Call of Duty so much now. It's the same thing every damn year, you know?
Right.
Oh, we're just going to go more into the future because where else are we going to go, right? I don't know.
That's
I just think
typically
it's...
Oh,
that's such bullshit. That's such bullshit, Matt.
What do you mean?
Because they've been saying that since Modern Warfare 2. Or really since ever... They've been saying this for years now. Oh, Call of Duty's the same game every year. If you compare the jump from Black Ops to Ghost, that's not that big of a jump. But if you look at the jump from Ghost to Advanced Warfare, and then Advanced Warfare to Black Ops 2, and now Black Ops 2 to Black Ops 3, and then Black Ops 3 to Infinite Warfare, there's a great change. And you can look at the change in Zombies and see Zombies has evolved. It's not the same game every year.
I'm talking about Call of Duty multiplayer.
Multiplayer's changed.
It's changed, Matt's
getting the perception. Everybody sees it as what it is. You still see the running gun. That's still true to Call of Duty. That's what it is at its core. And people are tired of that after 11 to 13 installments of Call of Duty at this point. But to your point, John, Treyarch and all the developers are innovating. They're constantly trying to change, but not change too much. You get these talks I've heard from the developers, damned if you do, damned if you don't. You change too much, everybody's upset at you. You change too little, it's the same game over and over again.
Well, here's what they've done. They've changed too much in Infinite Warfare. Now they have 2 million dislikes.
It's 2 million? Are you serious?
I think it might be close to 3 million. It's been a while since I've looked.
Whoa!
They're not that much.
If I may read, can I...
go for it.
Can I share my thought of what Zombies might be if Jimmy was still in control?
Yeah, please do.
I think what you do to answer this question is to look at some of Jimmy's loose ends.
Yes.
And I think that may point to where his direction was. It may very well be that he actually intended to end it with Buried, because that seems like a good way to wrap up the story.
Right.
But he also left us with the Noctair and Toten loading screen, which kind of gave us this weird mystery of this scientist, and then there were also multiple clones. I'm not looking at it, so I think I might mess that up.
That's okay.
But that was that's a very puzzling image in zombies.
Mm-hmm.
He also introduced the Illuminati. The Illuminati seemed to have had a bit of a role. Richtofen was supposedly a spy for them. Maybe he could have gone back and revisited that.
Mm-hmm.
We also have Richtofen changing outfits in Ascension. Maybe Absolutely. We would have gone back and visited whatever happened in Ascension, why Richtofen changed his outfit. I think if we really want to see where Zelensky's direction was, we look at his loose ends and we see which paths he might have wanted to go back to.
That's an excellent point. I do see that thought process there. That is an interesting way to see what Jimmy would have pursued, because so many times he loved to let us try and fill in the blanks and then take what we said and then go a completely different direction just to prove that he had a different idea for zombies. That happened so many times.
Or what if we turn this into a game that jumped from different groups of survivors, mm-hmm. and we explore this through the flesh? He gave us a taste of the flesh.
He did. Broken
and then
arrow.
Maybe
the flesh.
If Jimmy continued to follow his vision, we could have saw what happened to the flesh as Richtofen or Maxis was in control.
Now, do you think he would have, at this point, it seems to me that storyline has gone its way. We didn't get enough information about it, but he used that entire story arc. We know from beginning to end what happened in Black Ops 2 Zombies, so why not try and create another story arc, whether it's going back and changing time, going revisiting Ascension Group type stuff. He put the seeds for the Vrilia. He started that whole thing with all the Vril, and Jason Blundell has run with that, but I don't think he would have abandoned the Vril stuff either. So I wonder if you would have gone back into that stuff as well, because you could have had prequel stuff before what happened in World at War, or you could have just attacked it from different perspectives, because playing the flesh almost seems to me like you're in a circle here. You're getting a rehash of Black Ops 2, and I don't think you would want to do that. Even from his perspective, he told his story, he put his hints. I mean, there's stuff he never touched on again from World at War and Black Ops 1 that we're only just seeing now because Jason Blundell's like sitting here with a flowchart like, I got to do something about this.
Or Monty's the one with the flowcharts.
Yeah, it's a good point.
Dempsey, I got to go check my flowcharts. I'll get back to you.
Okay, and actually, I have that up right here. Here's a quick cheat sheet. You all fought in World War I. Whoopee. You are badass heroes. That was true. That happened. Then later, some other versions... Oh, he even says that. Later, some other versions of you ended up as lab rats in some crazy World War II experiments. Experiments that left you kind of not smart. Your memories were mostly erased, and you just kind of stumbled and bumbled around time and space, oblivious to your past and future actions. So that's the WIS number 6.
Okay, you win. You're right. I guess you can consider the Origins timeline then to be the real one.
But even there, he says that Max is the first to get through. So he goes, Maxis, he was the first. The vessel...
Well, that's a is that a reference to Origins?
Right.
Because I guess the vessel's the Maxis drone.
Yeah. World 1 shielded him from the influences of 115. He opened the portal between worlds, and, well, that's where and when shit really went tits up. The world within the world got turned upside down and inside out, if you can imagine such a thing. So anyways, it was around then that I was forced to step in. But see, that's when he's forced to step in. That doesn't mean things weren't messed up beforehand. So that's why I'm curious. Zombies are existing in the Origins universe, right? So at that point, things are messed up. 115 is messing things up. But it's very possible that the Origins house, that is the original universe. No zombies exist there. And that is the whole original universe. And then everything else messed it up. That's the way.
I want to exactly co-sign on that yet, just because we don't understand the nature of the house.
True. That is another good point.
But it's getting weird at this point.
Yeah.
Because if Maxis is... Why is it that when Maxis goes through the Origins Rift, why is that the straw that broke the camel's back? That seems weird. How is everything that happened in World at War to Black Ops 2 not what broke the universe?
Exactly. And that's what I'm curious how Jason's going to spin this. I mean...
It just seems difficult. It seems difficult in terms of just an order of events.
Mm-hmm.
Because now, I guess, when you look at things from a chronological standpoint, not a literal time standpoint, you have to put Origins before everything.
It would seem so, but I think the universe has messed that up. I think we get back into that whole thing about the shattered mirror. I think that's such a great metaphor for what Jason's trying to teach us here, where everything's shattered. They're all sort of copies of the real world, all kind of happening at the same time. But there's really one universe that used to be okay, and we're trying to get back there.
That was a clever metaphor.
Yeah.
When he says, you haven't multiplied, it was really well done. Honestly, yes. I think Monty is one of the best written characters in Zombies. Mm. They have executed his character perfectly.
Interesting. What do you think about that, Queen? Do you like Monty or that this house?
I do. You know, and I'd seen some ciphers earlier on where it seemed like Monty was the higher up. He's the guy. He's above Maxis and everything, and it's coming true. So I don't know who he's going to end up being in the end. And he's really just a big, you know, other than he's might be a type of god or even the devil, who knows. Mm-hmm. But I have more ideas about like the house and the kids, the children and stuff like that.
Well, please elaborate on them.
Okay. Well, what I think is that when we saw like the Panzer and the zombies as toys, I think they really are still toys. They didn't come to life and become real. I think they really are still toys. I think that was definitely Edward Richtofen sitting there with Samantha. And I think the final ending will be, we're going to see Takeo, Nikolai, Dempsey, Richtofen all as children. And they're the children.
Oh, what a spin that would be. Oh,
yeah, and they're just playing a game. It could explain everything. I mean, it's already shown us, like, what's going on. They're toys. Why are they real now?
Oh my God. And think about this. If each of the kids were just trying to be like the toys themselves. So that's why mm-hmm. when people complain about the nationalities, why is Samantha's not to have a German accent? It was just a bunch of those kids making up this game.
Yeah. Oh. And it's possible that like maybe they're studying stuff in history and that's why their stories are all over the world and different locations. And I don't know. That's a little far-fetched. But
I don't know.
Disappoint the community.
I don't think so, though, because the thing is, it doesn't take away from the realism of it. We've already mm-hmm. had that shock of, like, it's just a game. But yeah. their ideas, their whole thought process were real realities that ended up occurring in all these different universes. So what they were making up was real. Not yeah. like before, where the origin's ending at first, everyone goes, it's all just a joke. Here, we've said, no. It all happened. It's all real. Everything you did was real. But now you get more information about how it happened and where these things were created from and where these tangible ideas leached off of. And that's what happened when 115 shattered the universe or whatever happened. It became a reality. And that's it's better than waking up from a dream ending.
Mm-hmm.
What do you guys think about Monty claiming to have created free will?
Ooh, right? What about that
stuff?
Yeah,
that was a pretty powerful wisp. Like, whoa.
Treyarch with the bold moves here.
Yeah.
Wow. And then the dark and good ether kind of mirroring heaven and hell. Like, this is a whole different perspective that we're getting in Zombies.
You think it's interesting, though, that free will doesn't really exist in the zombie storyline because we're the ones that control the character's actions?
See, this is stuff that they might not be intentional, but I love it. I love it. Yeah, isn't that a cool idea, too, to play with?
It also seems like there's multiple people who Monty's working with.
True,
right? Because I guess Monty claims to be a type of creator, since mm-hmm. I suppose he created free will, whatever that really means. Because mm-hmm. where does Monty's free will come from, then?
Okay.
But he says it was his idea, as if it was a group of people working on this, and that was something he came up with.
Fascinating point. Yeah, I remember that, and I kept thinking about that. It sounded more polytheistic than monotheistic.
Yeah.
That might actually fit better into Queen's idea there, that it's the children, and maybe Monty is a part of the children. Maybe it's the dad. Maybe it's a version of Maxis in that universe. That could make a lot of sense.
It's too much going on. I really want to see how Blundell ties all of this together.
I know. God, Revelations is such a perfect title for the last map.
You think it's going to be the name of the map?
I do. I really do think it is going to be the name of the map.
It'll be Resurrection 2.0.
What's the setting going to be? Like, where, you know, we're not going to go back to a house and be like playing zombies in a suburbs.
I really hope to God not. Mm-hmm. But I think we might have some interaction with the house. We're going to have some kind of interaction with this house, right?
Yeah.
But I think the entirety of the map can take place anywhere, because we've played with this idea of the infinite, and then there's all these multiverses and everything's coming together for this big ending, and we might travel to Maxis and we'll see him soon. Richtofen has all these quotes. We might show up in the forest, like we talked about this last week. the coolest thing they could ever do is for the last map, and they start talking, you know, it's called Revelations. It's got a thumbnail you don't quite understand, whatever it is. You click start, it starts counting down, and in the background, your characters get up from the fireplace. Like, to me, that would be like, oh, the whole time. They knew what they were doing again the whole time. And you see them walk towards the house, and that's the loading screen. And then there's a little cutscene, and then we get into our map wherever it is. That would be like, whoa. That's my vision for what it might be. But Jason Blundell, he can go anywhere. He set it up once again that he could do whatever he wants with zombies in this last DLC.
And I'll let him do whatever he wants because I'm happy.
Blundell is Dr. Monty.
No, honestly, that was my first thought when I heard Monty's voice. I'm like, is that Blundell?
Dude.
I guess, is it Malcolm McDermott or whatever? That's what people are saying.
I've heard multiple voice actors.
Those lines, some of those lines made me so happy. Tits up. Oh my God. I just fucking like, you guys are too good.
I love how he's telling Dempsey to watch his language and then
his language is just as bad.
Oh my goodness. All right. So final bit here. Last question of the day. Time attacks were implemented in Zombies. Do you guys like this? Now, if you don't know what these are the time trial challenges by getting to round 5 and 5 minutes, 10 and 13, and 30, round 22 and 32 minutes, and you get rewarded with these melee weapons. Do you like this? Do you think this adds to the gameplay in Zombies? Do you think they really did a good job with gameplay in Go Rod Crovy?
I don't know if there's something I'll ever find myself earning accidentally, and that's what is a little bit disappointing.
Hmm. Is it like you wish you could have found that accidentally, or that you were actually you just would have never done that?
I think as I play the game and as I continue to play the game as time goes on, I don't think I'll ever find myself accidentally earning one of those new melee weapons, and I probably aren't gonna rush for one either, which is disappointing.
It's really easy, dude. Like, I wasn't rushing.
I'm not sure you're disappointed
anything.
About
yeah it's
no,
not
I don't, in my head I just didn't think I would ever get it.
20 rounds in 32 minutes.
There's also 15 and 24, by the way.
It's 15 and 24?
There's one for the axe as well.
Oh, God. What? There's an axe?
You didn't know that?
Oh, no.
I just ruined it for you.
Oh. Well, while this renders, I know what I'm doing after this. Dang it. I was trying to make a quick
guide.
Yeah,
there's four of them.
I didn't know there was four.
5, 10, 15, 20.
Just like that,
but
reads back.
To be honest
mind.
With you, it glitches all of the time. Like,
does
so
it?
Much. Yeah.
It's been pretty good to me so far. In multiplayer, not so good.
Well,
if
you got the 20 in whatever it is, 32, you should have gotten the axe, ideally, if you're on time. You know?
What was the axe?
It's 15
and 24 minutes?
Yeah, but it's for me, it's always not worked. I've seen other people get it, though. But it's never worked for me.
I will definitely test that out, and then I can share my experiences. I've only had one frustration, and it's finding Gersh. That has been the worst thing ever. Oh, my God. In solo, in multiplayer, no problem. But in solo, he just hides on me. He doesn't keep moving. He goes and stays stationary.
You
and I look
at
about 8 to 9 spots, and he never shows up there. And then the one he shows up in, it's just like right at the last second, he's gone. And it's just like, son of a bitch. I can't find where he's hiding on me.
I was doing that today. I literally was just like about to have a meltdown. That was just like the Dingo pack a bench is like the only thing that really works good.
Right.
Rego
Dingo
works
and
really
Haymaker.
Well.
Those are the only things that get him almost immediately to be like, oh, stop that and trigger the quote. I'm glad I'm not alone. I was talking to Milo and he's like, dude, you suck. And I'm like, God damn it. That's not helping Milo.
I think the original Ray Gun worked really well for us.
Okay.
Well, you want to try,
I'm
that,
try
well.
That stuff out? God damn, Gersh! Because now I'm like shocked, almost in solo, that Gersh is like the hardest step for me. Because just trying to find him, he just keeps running, and then I never find him. He hides. It's like,
I wonder if there's like a trick for like maybe blast him with the shield fireball or something.
You know,
like,
that might be
we don't know.
Too.
You know, there's a trick to make it easier because it's very, very challenging. So.
He runs so far away. That's what blows my mind about it. It's just like he goes. You're trying to chase him in solo. You have zombies sprinting at you. And then he gets in these situations where, does it glitch on you too with the audio? Where if you fail the round, you can hear it everywhere, Gersh's audio?
Yeah.
Son of a bitch! I'm so glad I'm not alone.
Yeah.
Oh my God, it's the worst, because now you don't know, you're trying to listen for him, and he's everywhere now.
Yeah, it doesn't help, no.
God dang.
Another one that's hard is that Samantha's music box for the Max Ammo and the Revelation song. Holy crap, that is really challenging. Oh, just for Max Ambo, it's just like, oh my god.
Right? Just to get the monkeys out of the box has been a frustration unbelievable to me. Ay, 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 these things are crazy. But Time Attacks, sorry, venting over about that. But Time Attacks, do you guys like this? I think Matt did. John, you're a little disappointed. Yeah. Queen, how do you feel about it?
I love anything that they implement with zombies. I'm open-minded to it, and I love it. So I would probably not go in just with a regular game. I would be prepared to do it that specifically, you know, set a game aside for that. And that's cool. I mean, I think you don't have to do it. It's there for the people that want to. So that's awesome.
Lex and I had this idea that when you complete the Easter egg, it gives you a time to complete Easter egg, right? Yes. It'll give you time to complete the last round that you're on when you die as well. But the Easter egg one was specific. It said quest completed in blank.
Right.
So I was like, I thought that it was just because, just for record purposes, right? So if you want to do the fastest world record run for the Easter egg, you can officially time it now in game and it shows you what it is. But Lex had this idea that if you complete the Easter egg in a certain amount of time, maybe you get another melee weapon or another unlocked item. And I was like, that's interesting.
I think it's possible. I really do. And so I think we should try that eventually.
Yeah, we tried. Pat, Lex, and I tried it. We didn't get it very fast. We got like an hour and 20 minutes. But if you get it, I was thinking under 115 might be really cool if they put that in there.
Oh, that's that, Matt. I like it. I like the way you think right there.
It sounds cool, but I don't know. I don't, you know, there's only one way to find out.
It's very possible. We can get to phase two in less than 30 minutes as long as you have a shopping free and a perkaholic. So it's not out of the question. And then the Nikolai fight, I've heard if you use the death machines, you can just lay waste to him.
Yeah.
So I think it's got to get tested. It probably will by the time I'm on vacation. Someone might crack it. But if not, on the way back, I want to try this.
Absolutely.
Well, do you guys have any lasting thoughts about Gorod Krovi before we take off here?
How do you guys like the Easter egg?
I liked it a lot, but Monty saved the whole thing. Like, initially, they cut Nikolai too short, in my opinion. And then to do the whole to be continued next week in Gorod Krovi or in Revelations, you'll get the ending and all that. Just like, we know.
It wasn't necessary. We knew it was coming.
I know they're trying to make it like a movie presentation, but it was just like, so much was going so well. The quest itself for the Easter egg was awesome. Everything made sense. We got callbacks to Gersh. That was amazing. You had all these different things that made sense. Oh, we had these faulty drones. Sophia coming back. Oh, perfect.
Yeah. I wish they replaced Sophia with more Ascension Group technology.
Yeah, I could see that. Why you would want that.
I would have liked to explore them a little bit more.
Definitely. Because
now Sophia just is in this weird place in the zombie storyline, I feel like.
I don't know if it's weird, per se. She does this awesome parallel to Maxis now in the machinery. And you're seeing these different universes where the shattered stuff, you know, we get back into that, that is slightly different. Richtofen doesn't understand it. He's like, hey, guys, she was a secretary. I have no idea what's going on in my life anymore. And you hear the lines blow for blow, except it just changes it. Instead of Samantha, it's Maxis. I must go to her. I must go to him. And the paradox must be resolved. That's awesome, because you know it's got to come up in the next map. If Jason Blundell went out of his way to take an almost insignificant character and put such a large role into that and bring back that whole machinery thing, you ever heard her quotes about, like, what makes you live? Is blood what makes you you? Is thoughts what makes you you? I'm kind of paraphrasing here because I don't remember off the top of my head, but she has these deep-seated quotes that you're just like, all right, I'm trying to play a game here. Let's take it back a notch, Sophia. But she's really calling into the idea of what is existence. And that's something I think that should be explored in our crazy zombie universe. How do you guys feel about the Easter egg too, John and Matt?
I like it. I mean, I haven't actually completed the Easter egg myself. I've had multiple solo attempts that all seem to go poorly for one reason or another. And like you, I'm pretty happy with the ending. I think Gersh did save it. Had we not had those Gersh quotes at the end,
Gersh or Monty,
I would have said it was a disappointing ending.
Gersh or Monty. Well,
overall, though, what?
Monty. Gersh or Monty.
Monty.
Okay,
Monty.
Just, don't mean to say Gersh.
There's
actually more Gersh quotes, by the way, because I've failed so much. You actually hear him having conversations with Yuri. And I was like, what?
Yeah, Money was telling me about that earlier today. Yeah. He sent me this file.
Yeah, his file sucks.
Yeah, the audio.
I can be real with you.
Yeah, I'm listening to it, and I'm like, I can hardly hear what he's saying. And then Money tried, like, playing it backwards and doing all these different things.
No, it's straight up. You can hear it very clearly, because I normally play with audio settings messed up. they're actually having a conversation when you can't hit him for shit, but he's like taunting you. You're close enough to hear him talking, and you're just like, I'm going to murder you so hard, Gersh. And you just can't find
I'm gonna
him.
I'm going to murder you so hard. In the face.
Reed is an angry zombie player.
Yeah. Dude, this Easter egg has done things to me solo that I haven't experienced this since, like, maybe Call of the Dead anger. Oh, George was not cool before Mule Kick was on that map. Oh, man. That seems to be it, if you guys are happy with all that. I want to thank Glitching Queen so much for coming on to this week. Where can we find all your stuff?
My stuff?
Yeah, like YouTube, Twitter. Where could everybody find you if they don't know you somehow?
YouTube. I have a YouTube channel, Glitching Queen, and a Twitter. And I'm really just kind of, that's my only social media because I'm just kind of lazy. So, that's about it,
Well, that's fantastic. And as you guys know, she'll be linked down in the links down below in the description, on screen in the cards. And Matt, John, you have anything to leave us with?
No, I hope everybody had enjoyed the show and has a great day.
Yep, I'm glad to be back. And Space Dog is too. See you guys later.
There we go. Thank you guys so much for watching. And we will see you next week on the next episode of Zombros. Bye.